Well, welcome to another Bible Truth broadcast. I'm Evangelist Tom Gillum. I'm an itinerant evangelist, believes in expositional preaching. I like to do it line upon line, precept upon precept. I like to do it in a series form. I like to do it with enthusiasm. Joy to have you here on the broadcast. I hope you have a Bible handy, a notebook, something to write with. You'll find our text today in Romans chapter number 5. We began on the last broadcast a series of messages, take us a while to go through them, on the 18 times that Paul used the little phrase, much more. And we're preaching in these days on Paul's much more. And this little idea, Jesus is this, that, and so much more. 18 is a number that is always connected with bondage in the scripture. And of course, the overriding greatest bondage is a bondage to sin. Made up of two numbers, the number of 10, which is the number of completeness or fullness, and 8, the number of the new birth. The new birth is the only thing that can make you complete and full and set you free from the bondage of sin. And Jesus is this, He's that, and He's so much more. We began on our last broadcast looking in Romans chapter number 5. Notice verse number 9. Much more then, being now justified by His blood, we shall be saved from wrath through Him. And we're looking in these days at the power of the much mores over bondage. We looked last time at a powerful basis, and today we want to look at a powerful bestowment. A powerful bestowment. It is here in verse number 9 that Paul begins to turn towards laying out for us these much mores. And we see in verse number 9 the much more of justification. He said much more than being now justified, duh. Notice that little ED on that word. That puts it in a tense where there has been something done in the past that will guarantee that something shall be done in the present. This little word justify means to be declared innocent of all charges. It means to be declared absolutely holy, innocent, righteous, absolved of all sins, just like they never happened. To be declared to be justified, to be just like Jesus. And He said it was all done by His blood. There was a past action. How did I get justified? I got justified at Calvary. No wonder the old man said, when did you get saved? He told him, he said, I got saved about 2,000 years ago, about 3 o'clock, one afternoon on Calvary's cross. How come? He's this, He's that, and He's so much more. I see that it is by His blood. It is not the blood of bulls. It's not the blood of goats. It's not the blood of a lamb. It's not the blood of a pigeon. But it is God's blood. He shed His blood to ensure the present tense that in 1968 I would witness the justifying of my soul before a holy and a righteous God. What in the world did He do with my sin? He drowned them in His blood. They never exist anymore. I have been declared to be just like Jesus. I'm telling you today, He's this, He's that, and He's so much more. We see not only the much more of justification, but we see the much more of reconciliation. He said in verse number 10, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. My prior state was that of an enemy.
that of a one who hated in my soul, was hostile to all the ways of God. But because of Christ's death upon the cross, that blood reconciled God and I and made us one. And now, instead of being an enemy, I'm a friend of God. Yay! I am His best friend. Matter of fact, He told me I was the apple of His eye. He is this, He is that, and He's so much more. He said this reconciliation in verse number 10, I am saved by His life. That little word saved, protected, hedged about, made complete by my life. No. By His life, by His breath. He has breathed into me the very breath of God. I can never stop breathing. Oh, I might exhale here one day and they'll say He's dead, but I'll inhale over there. How come? Because He's this, He's that, and He's so much more. Much more has not only made me friends with God through His death, it has set me free from the bondage of sin. How in this world can God make me His best friend, the apple of His eye? Because when He looks at me, He doesn't see me anymore. But He sees His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and He sees my sins gone. They've been absolved. It's like they were never committed at all. Not only do I see in this text a powerful basis, powerful bestowment, but I see a powerful beauty. I notice there is in this beauty a bitter grave. He says in verse number 15, but not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. The first Adam, Adam in the garden, our papa and our granny Eve, all they could ever offer us is death, more death and more death. All they could offer us was the flesh, the world, and the devil. That's all they could ever offer us, was the gift of death. The whole human race plunged into the bondage of sin. I heard a preacher some time ago telling a youth group, preaching to a youth group. He told them that sin was a human thing. It was natural. I'm telling you today, in the sight of God, it's not natural. Oh, it's not. It will throw you into the depths of deadness and darkness and depravity and damning your soul to hell. And because of that, the first Adam plunged us into a whole human race into total depravity. I came out of my mama's womb. I was blind. I was deaf. I was dumb. I was dead. I had no ability to come, and I couldn't cease from sin. And lest He came to me, justified me, and reconciled me to God, I would have went to hell. That's all the first Adam ever offered me, the powerful beauty. He offered a bitter grave. But I see also in our text, not only a bitter grave in this powerful beauty, but I see a beautiful grace. He says in verse 17, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. The first Adam made us a slave in bondage to sin. But those that believe in the second Adam receive much more abundant grace, excessive grace. Consequences of the first Adam created a problem that no man could solve. But the second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ, created a solution that no man can do. Only Him. How come? He's this, He's that, and He's so much more. how abundant is this grace? Paul defined grace in 2 Corinthians chapter number 8. He said, he who was rich for our sakes became poor, that we through his poverty might be made rich. How rich was he? I tell you how rich he was. They paved the streets in his world with gold. He was reigning on a throne of a glassy sea. The walls in his city was of jewels. The gates to his city were 18-foot pearls. He had a 360-degree rainbow around his throne. And the angels, the seraphim were flying around crying, holy, holy, holy. That's how rich he was. But he became poor for our sakes. How poor did he become? I'm telling you, he had a borrowed stable, had a borrowed manger, had nowhere to lay his head. He didn't even have a money to pay his taxes, had to catch a fish and find the money in his mouth. He didn't even have a tomb to bury him in. He had to borrow a tomb. That's how poor he became. But he became poor. How come? That you and I may enjoy his riches. How come? He's this, he's that, and he's so much more. Powerful basis, powerful bestowment, powerful beauty. But I close the little thought in this second series of the power of the much more's over bondage with the powerful bounty. He says in chapter 5 and verse 20, moreover the law entered, that the offense might abound. He sees the examples of this bounty. Men with abundant sin, but grace does much more abound. I think of the illustration of John Newton. He was an old vulgar mouth, a slave trader. And he became a slave himself on his own ship. And God saved his soul. And he later wrote Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Because of Jesus being this and that and so much more. John Newton was set free by the new birth. And he was given the bounty of God's grace. Think about old John Bunyan. He was a tinker. He was a violent life of sin, had a vulgar mouth, but God saved him. And he wrote Pilgrim's Progress, and he wrote that great biography, Grace Abounding. How come? How can an old tinker, old vulgar mouth tinker get saved? Because Jesus is this, he's that, and he's so much more. The examples of this bounty, but I see the extent of this bounty. He says there in verse 20, moreover the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, where there's sin in abundance, those who know great sin, when they get saved, that they can see so clearly the grace of God. And I'm not saying we ought to live a sinful life so we know grace. Oh no, folks that have never sinned practically, they can see how wicked they are inside, see how grace abounded. But oh, I see the extent of this bounty. He says that how grace did much more abound. I was thinking in closing of a very simple soul, a simple man by the name of Sam Duncan. He loved to cut out pictures and put a little caption under the picture and maybe write a poem. He cut out a picture one day, and he would send them to friends as words of encouragement. He cut out a picture one day of Niagara Falls, and he wrote a little poem underneath of the story. And he says, have you on the Lord believed? He said, there's still more to follow. He says, on his grace have you received, still there's more to follow. All the grace the Father shows, still there's more to follow. He says, freely is his grace bestowed, still there's more to follow. More and more and more and more, always more grace to follow. Oh, His matchless, boundless grace, still there's more to follow. Sam put under the caption of Niagara Falls, he said, still there's more to follow. Oh, I tell you, because of Jesus being this, that, and so much more, there is more grace to follow for the child of God, the redeemed of God. He has damn broke the grace of God, and it keeps flowing to us unendingly. Well, it's been a joy to have you on the broadcast today. Remember our study website, tomgillum.com. Have a prayer request, interested in a meeting. I'm an itinerant evangelist. Calendar's on that website. You can email me at tbgillum@aol.com. Thanks for listening today.